Hey, my name is Morgan Page. I'm a DJ, remixer, producer. I make electronic music in all forms. Currently, the stuff I'm doing is very progressive electro. It's house music that's made for the clubs. So I spend a lot of time flying around, playing in clubs, playing my music loudly. I did tell my parents, I remember in my early 20s, I said to them, I said, Grammy by 30. It was obviously a huge honor to get nominated for a Grammy. And seeing that on both sides of the table was really cool. To be the original artist getting remixed when Deadmau5 did a remix for me and got nominated. And then a few years later when it was my remix for Nadia Ali. Here in the studio, I've got my Barefoots, my main monitors. I have these smaller monitors just to hear what it sounds like on, you know, smaller systems. I think it's good to have two to kind of reference things on. It's a custom-built room. And it's it's really focused on just having a very tight stereo image right in the center that's just flat and balanced. You know, there's enough space to fit things like I have a piano in here that's 70 years old. It's a vintage Steinway. I have analog keyboards. I have a Dave Smith Prophet 08. I have the Moog Voyager, and I just use these guys as controllers. This is just a little Yamaha, and I have various hardware compressors, SSL clones. Avalon 737, an 1176 clone here as well, made by Purple. So I use those for vocal tracking, and then everything else is pretty much done digitally. So the bulk of everything is done in the computer. Well, I think I've been inspired by, you know, watching a lot of the Waves guys, you know, Tony Maserati. I use a lot of his plugins, you know, Spike Stent with, the new plugin that he came out with, the mixing NLS plugin. You know, even guys like Rick Rubin, who are pure producers and aren't really engineers, they're really inspiring to me. T-Bone Burnett. These guys that can just shape sound, and I like to draw from these other genres. The first thing that I always gravitate towards when I'm creating or listening is the chord progression. You know, is the chord part of the rhythm? Is it, are there stabs, or is it sustained, or is it strummed? How is it performed? And then what is the lead? Like, what's the hook? So I'm still drawn to a lot of this traditional pop structure stuff. It doesn't have to be bad because it's pop. You know, I think I'm fascinated by what makes these records work. And I think you see a lot of producers like Dr. Luke that have kind of figured it out. And you know, you read these, you know, in the very few interviews guys like him do, he talks about being fascinated with these elements that are sort of universal in all his records. So I think that stuff, that continual quest to find ways to trigger emotion, are what keeps me going. And that's what I listen for in other records. The kick drum is about 70%, 80% of the track. And if the kick drum is bad, the track is just not going to work. So the kick's got to be there. A catchy chord progression has to be there. There has to be a hook and a lead. It has to work live. And you find out pretty quickly if it doesn't work with the crowd. They kind of vote with their feet. And you see just the look in their face, like if they're happy or if they're bored. And you got to cater to that attention span. So with a dance record, there's all these little sort of areas you have to check off, like, you know, does it sound big? Is it punchy? Will it mix well with other records? Does the syncopation talk to another record? So when I DJ, the records have to talk to each other. If they don't, the mix just sounds awkward and doesn't work. So you have to balance all these other areas that, you know, if you're doing a rock record, you're not really thinking about how it's mixing with somebody else's record. With dance, it's I try not to have the records have too much swing in the beginning or too much quantization, because then it's going to be harder to mix with other records. So being a DJ and a producer, it's sort of this yin-yang thing. Like, I have to think like a DJ and a producer and wear both hats. When I do a remix or an original, I'll compose it in my head before I even get into the studio. So I'll think like, oh, maybe just a very raw, sawtooth, sustained chord progression will work for this. And then I'll do a vocoder on the lead vocal and just pitch that to the key of the song. And that'll work, and I'll just filter it and keep it simple. Or maybe I'll be like, it's driven by an arpeggio. It has a very A-B arrangement where one part is electro, one part is progressive, and it flip-flops back and forth between the two. I use a lot of templates, and I think the important thing with templates is not to get locked into a certain way of working, not to paint yourself into a corner. So I'll set templates up in a flexible way where there'll be compression on there, or be a very basic starting setting on there. Instead of having it be some extreme telephone effect on it, like with an EQ or anything, it's very basic. Like, I know that I'm going to do a lot of high passing and a lot of low passing, and be just cutting out rumble or just removing some of the very top end. And so I'll set the plugin with that initially, maybe have it bypassed, and just build a very, really flexible, versatile template. I don't want to be hearing the song, you know, more than I have to, because you kind of hit that point of no return. If you hear it 500 times, you lose your objectivity to it. and I think the work can suffer. So I think it's important to just automate the stuff that is left brain. And so you're not thinking about it too much. You're not thinking about the routing of this, and this output's going to this input. So that's what I like. And you know, I love being able to group my plugins together into sort of suites of plugins. And depending on what DAW you use, you know, it's, you know, it varies. But I think I've been doing that a lot with Ableton and chaining the Waves plugins together. I love that. You can just have them all there and then create custom key settings and macros and things to quickly make changes on the fly. I think that flexibility of having you know, tangible control with the plugins, where it can almost feel like hardware, but then having the recall of digital is obviously huge. With vocals and things, I have to work with, be able to recall presets for different vocalists. I have to be able to have mix templates there ready to go. There isn't time to sort of mess around with restructuring everything and routing everything in different places. My first experience with Waves was in radio. They had sort of a broadcast suite at Emerson College in Boston, and we had this multi-million dollar radio station being run by students, and it was great because we had all the Waves plugins in the suites, and I remember just messing around with like Enigma and these Doppler plugins and pitch shifting my voice and just being like, wow, this is crazy. Like, I just kind of got addicted to a few of the plugins and then bought some suites, and I think every year I've kind of added more and more on. I think I use Waves in a real variety of ways. Obviously, a lot of compression with it. Sidechaining is very big with electronic music. So, you know, I'll sidechain with the Waves plugins, and I'll use them a lot for the vocal tracking, or for, you know, just tweaking the vocal and pulling all the elements out of the mix. Like, I love Vocal Rider and, you know, Waves Maserati, and I really like the multi-band compression. I like to use just a touch of that on the master. And, you know, I really like the hybrid series. Like, so the hybrid EQ, the compressor's cool, the hybrid delay is really fun. The trickiest thing is vocals to me, and I have to be able to work really quickly. And like I was saying earlier, you know, with templates always help. But being able to just get that good sound quickly is the most important thing. That's why I like the Maserati bundle, especially for vocals. You can dial it in quickly. You're not worried about compression ratios and thinking logically about it. You're just going by feel. And as long as you get a good gain structure in there, as long as you're tweaking it, you can get that sound really quickly and just move on and worry more about just getting the takes that you need and having the vocals hit the right notes. I've always loved the SSL series. They just have that, you know, specific sound, the way that it just hits, the attack on the compressor, I like a lot. So I like to run stuff really hard through the SSL, the 4000 sometimes. I like that series. The API 2500 is really nice, very different for like a slower attack. I think everything has a cool effect, and you know, some engineers like to stack a vocal and molt it out, you know, so it's simultaneously being compressed with different, you know, faster attacks or slower attacks and different release times, and to sort of build this thickness. And I think, you know, like a Coldplay, they use that on the vocal for Chris Martin. That's like one trick. But it's just a cool way to get these different, get a different timbre out of the vocalist, and you can kind of mix each different compressor in the mix. If you have three different versions of the vocal with three different compressors, you can change that balance in the mix. So I really like, yeah, the API, the SSL. I think the V series is great as well. You know, sometimes I like to treat remix stems with multi-band compressors and limiters like the L3. So kind of sweeten them up and just sort of just, I don't know, just exaggerate these sounds a little bit. So if I get stems from a vocalist and the vocal sounds kind of weak and sounds kind of underperformed, I can kind of pump it up a little bit. In the past, I've done a hardware summing for the last couple of records, and which is, it's cool. It adds a nice little boost, but I can't bring that on the plane. I can't bring that out at when I travel. And I recently started using the NLS plugin for summing, which is really cool because you get that little summing sound, you know, it knocks out all the peaks. And you can squash it by pressing the mic switch on there and do some fun stuff with distortion and messing with the texture of it. It just sounds good, you know, it just has a nice, it gets a different feel. It sounds like a console. And I mean, most of my experience is with electronic music, and sometimes those subtleties bring out different timbres and instruments and things. And if you're avoiding peaking and you can get more texture out of an instrument, I think it's really useful. I feel like with electronic music, the stuff is getting pumped through compressors in the club anyways, so what I'll do is just really drop down the breakdowns, make them extra quiet. I'll bring them down another 6 dB because I know my limiter is going to pump them up. So I'll mix with the limiter on I try to get the mix really balanced and have the master be subtle, and then later on worry about these big drops so that the breakdowns are quiet and they're not getting too pumped up and too amplified. And then when it comes back in, it's really loud. So you have to kind of surprise people, and people love little, you know, silent interludes in the club and when the kick drops out. So it's all about the drop and the build up. So I will do both. I will have quiet parts where I make sure that the levels are dropped and that the limiter isn't distorting them at all, and then I have it so that the mix is coming back in, it's hitting hard. But I think it's important to me that it's loud, but that it's still has a little bit of room, so it's not getting super squashed by broadcast compressors at radio or compressors at the club. And so there's little tricks I'll do. So when the mix is coming back in, let's say there's a snare hit before there's a drop, I make sure there's a little bit of silence so the compressors reset at the club. And so it just doesn't sound like mush. So it gives a little break, the compressor resets, and then bam, the kick drops in. My goal is to have things balanced. So when you turn it up loud, things aren't honking and resonating in a bad way. So it's important to have it be balanced and that the low end is in control, because if the low end's out of control, it's going to be a quieter mix. It's going to take up all that bandwidth, and it's going to make the club's compressors and subs work too hard, and in some cases will turn off their subwoofers. It'll just go overload. The one Waves plugin that really kind of shined for me was using like the L3, the multi-maximizer, and I think when I go back on a mix and especially an older mix where I have to resubmit it for, like a TV commercial or movie or something, and I want to add some sparkle, some more punch, and maybe the mix is like 3 or 4 years old and just sounds a little different, needs to be a little louder. If I can't hear a certain instrument or a certain range of frequencies, I can kind of pull it up in there, and it just makes it kind of jump out a little more. And I think one day I had to quickly turn it around. I had to find this old session, and I threw the L3 on there, and it just kind of, even the people, the person listening to it for this commercial was like, whoa, what did you do to the track? It sounds like so much bigger than before. So yeah, it definitely saved the day. So there's a lot of great mastering houses I use, like the Lodge and Sterling Sound, and they do amazing work. But to be able to see it from start to finish, you either have to really trust your mastering engineer or do it yourself. And the tools are so good now that I don't need banks and racks of analog gear to get the job done. It's caught up. I'll use the hybrid EQ a lot. Some of the stuff that's just good for kind of broadcast compression are good. Some of the multi-band compressors like the L3, the API, the 2500. I have that, and SSL is just slightly compressing the master on there as well. I like short delays to kind of create a wider stereo image, but H delay is always the go-to. That's what I always use. It's just the simplest. And I'm always trying to aim to pull elements away from the kick and move things to the outer region of the stereo image, which is hard. And I want it to be something that translates into mono, because a lot of clubs sum a good chunk of their sound systems to mono. And if it's playing in a department store or on someone's iPhone, you want stuff to still work in mono. So I think if it works in mono, I think that's important. A lot of guys ignore that. You just got to choose what gets compromised. Like maybe the tambourine doesn't have to be incredibly wide, wide, and it can come down a lot when it sums to mono. But that chord progression really needs to be there. It can't disappear, and the vocal can't disappear, and the bass line can't disappear. So you got to prioritize your panning. I get asked so often, like, what are my tips for upcoming producers and things? And having done it so long, I've kind of written down my ideas and little tips along the way for the last 15 years of making music. So I am going to publish a little book called MP Quick Tips, and it's just kind of inspired by like these tweets that I've done. I do like a daily tweet, and I try to have it be just a really useful tip, hopefully not too many diversions, and a tip to inspire you, not like, here's what I know, try this out. It's more like, here's something fun to try that may dissolve writer's block or may inspire your next chord progression or your next instrument purchase or whatever way you want to attack the song. If people want to find more information about me, you can check out all my social sites, facebook.com/morganpage, twitter.com/morganpage. My official site is morgan-page.com, so there's a bunch of free bootleg remixes on there, and free DJ mixes. I do a weekly podcast and satellite radio show for Sirius XM. So that comes out I do it every Monday, but it comes out, they broadcast it on Thursdays on BPM on Sirius XM. So definitely check that out. You can get that on iTunes if you just search for Morgan Page on there, and also at soundcloud.com/morganpage. So it's a 1 hour free mix every week. Thanks for joining me here in my studio here in Los Angeles. Hopefully all these tips have helped out and you've learned some good little tricks with Waves plugins. So thanks again, and I'll see you soon.